Good morning. Welcome to Atkinson Congregational Church. We are the light on the hill, where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome. A very special welcome to those of you who are visiting for the first time or the first time in a long time. We're very glad that you could be with us this morning. And if you joined us online, we're very glad to see you as well. If you want to find out more about the light on the hill, you or sign up for our newsletters, you can go to our website, atkinsoncc.org. And there's instructions there on how to do that. Also on the website is a page devoted to the live stream of today's service and also archive services, so you can go back and look at services from previous weeks. We're still also stocking our YouTube channel, so if that's where you go to look at previous services, they are there as well. New this week, we've added another page, another playlist on our music page, and have uploaded over a dozen pieces performed by our bell choir, including three brand new ones, which you'll be seeing in the weeks to come. So you can go to the music page on the website and look at any of those. There's, I think, 15 or 16 pieces uploaded there now, which is wonderful. Some folks have expressed interest in membership. If that is you, I encourage you to be in touch with Lynn in the office or email her at office@atkinsoncc.org, and she will be back in touch with you. We were probably doing bringing in some new members in January, so if you're interested in that, please be in touch. And we have a couple of announcements this morning. Vicki, I'll let you go first.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. So nice to see everybody. Okay, so my announcement is the calendar and card fundraiser that I do over the years has now kicked off. And lucky you, we're starting today, and you'll have a sneak peek if you decide to come back into Fellowship Hall after the service to see the calendar and cards. So we've got two again this year. We've got one of the beautiful church. Each month is obviously a seasonal representation of a place here at church. And then the second calendar is a scenic calendar, and it's just different places in the world. And the scenic calendar includes quotes by famous and historical people, and the church calendar features biblical scriptures. So this is a fundraiser for the church, so all the profits go back to the church, and the calendars are $20 each. And then we also have a whole bunch of note cards available, and they are $2 each. So, you know, I've got a huge selection that you can view out in Lovejoy Hall. And the benefit of being able to see them in person is you can see them physically and look at them and touch them. But also there are some limited edition scenes that I'm not selling online. It just becomes too unwieldy to have them all available online. So I welcome you to check it out, and I'll be doing this for the next several weeks. So I'm looking forward to seeing you. Thank you.
Thanks, Vicki. Kristen?
Just to finish on Vicki's announcement, there'll be a button on the homepage to order the calendar and the cards online. That's almost ready. I'm also kicking off the 2021 Advent calendar. Last year, we started an online Advent calendar. We're going to continue with that. And this year, since we're all together, I wanted to invite everybody to participate and offer up some of their artistic talents. All ages are accepted and welcome, and all mediums are welcome. The only thing is it needs to be on a square piece of paper. The color and the size doesn't matter. I can work with anything. And we'd love to feature anybody in all of your beautiful designs in our Advent calendar this year. I'll leave this out in Lovejoy Hall on the table next to the Giving Tree.
Thanks, Kristen. Any other announcements this morning? Then, friends, let's be... Oh, yes, Adele.
It's time for us to have our Giving Tree out in Lovejoy's Hall. And for those of you who don't know what a Giving Tree is, at the moment it's a lot of forsythia branches, but it's going to change so it looks like a small Christmas tree. On that small Christmas tree are envelopes. And on the envelope it says, that your donation would be used to plow the driveway or buy new supplies, a variety of things in that involving the church, that if we contribute to the giving tree, it will help a lot. And it's kind of fun because I make the effort to decorate all the envelopes. And, you know, it's one of those little nothing things that you get into a habit of doing it. And I really missed it this year. The only thing that make it easier, if you come in through Fellowship Hall instead of coming in this door, then you'll see the giving tree and you'll say, oh yeah, I was going to do that. That's it. Thank you.
Thanks, Adele. So we have... Oh, that's okay. We have sort of opened back up Fellowship Hall beginning this week. Vicki will be in there with the card and calendar sales, and you can pick up the squares to do a piece of art for the Advent calendar, and the giving tree is on that same table. Right now it's the yellow for Cynthia, and that'll change in the weeks to come. But so we're getting a little more back to normal every day. Well, we begin worship each week with our call to worship. It's responsive, and you're invited to reply with the words that are printed in bold. And friends, let's be in worship together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Come, let us give thanks to God. Come, let us give thanks to Christ. Come, let us give thanks to the Spirit. Our opening hymn this morning is Come Thou Almighty King. The words will be on the screens.
Praise Father, all glorious, for all things sore.
Let us pray. God of wind and fire, of darkness and of light, speak to us in this hour of worship. Calm our fears and grant us the assurance of things hoped for. Overcome our anxieties and calm the troubled waters in our lives. Grant to us a heart of peace and a tongue of praise and holy hands to raise in prayer to you. Grant that we may gain new confidence in your mercy and new strength to do your will and to shine with your light before others. We ask these things in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. We cry out longing for the touch of God. We're humbled by the awareness of our human nature and our brokenness. And so we bring our prayers of confession to God as we pray together a unison prayer of confession. We have to admit, holy listener, that we are more likely to be irritated by the lives of others rather than being provoked to love them. When we are called to encourage those around us, too often our actions and words discourage them. Offered lives of peace and hope, we wander around filled with anxiety and despair. Forgive us, Rock of Redemption. Cleanse our hearts so we might be more loving. Keep us on the path of faithfulness so we might find those whom we are called to serve. Give us your words so we might confess your hope offered to all who are broken, who lost, who cry out to you. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. This is the good news. God gives us hope. God gives us peace. God gives us joy so we might share these gifts with everyone we meet. Thanks. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning comes from the letter to the Hebrews from the 10th chapter. Our reader is Kay Galloway.
Morning, everyone. Every priest stands every day serving and offering the same sacrifices over and over. Sacrifice for sins for all time. He sat down at the right side of God. Since then, he's waiting until his enemies are made into a footstool for his feet. Because he perfected the people who are being made holy with one offering for all time. Brothers and sisters, we have confidence that we can enter the Holy of Holies by means of Jesus' blood, through a new and living way that he opened up for us through the curtain, which is his body. And we have a great high priest over God's house. Therefore, let's draw near with a genuine heart and the certainty that our faith gives us, since our hearts are sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies are washed with pure water. Let's hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering, because the one who made the promises is reliable. And let us consider each other carefully for the purpose of sparking love and good deeds. Don't stop meeting together with other believers, which some people have gotten into the habit of doing. Instead, encourage each other, especially as you see the day drawing near. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And we'll move into our time of prayer, and we'll begin that with sharing of the prayers that have been come to us over the past week in the office, and also those that have been shared with folks that are here in person this morning. And so I invite Gloria Dodge to come up and begin.
The prayer requests for today are prayers for good test results,
prayers for courage, strength, and hope, a healing path, and good test results for me. Not me, that was be the writer. Happiness and healing for Ricky, AJ, CJ, and Nick. Connie, Cooper, Cheryl, Mel, and Maria. The Kamets and our department. Thank you for all our blessings. For good test results, Gus and Carol. For good test results for Linda. For the Christian family as they mourn the passing of Dodd. For continued good health, John Cummings, a special wife and daughter, answered prayers, Emily and Daisy, Clay and Emily, my sister Mary and her husband Jimmy, good health for everyone, for Martha and family, for daily laughter, joy, hope, and peace. Love and comfort for Gail's family. Love and courage for all affected by the Seaport Trillium fire last night. It sounds like it might be Newburyport. I don't know. Safe travel for Shane and Meg. Healing prayers for Kristen, Pam, Joyce, Hal, Paige, Andy, Steph, and Jordan. Prayers for a successful journey. Good test results for me this week. Jennifer Beckett. Happiness and a healing path for Ricky. JT, Lolo, Sybil, Paul, thank you for a wonderful family and sunshine. Those are the prayer requests for today. Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious and merciful God, you who open the gates to heaven to all who call upon you, we thank you for your unconditional love. A love that asks us to do the best we can and which embraces us with warmth and encouragement when we stumble. Help us, O God, to live by that love and to announce that love and show that love to all of our brothers and sisters. Lord of light, source of all that is eternal, you who drive out darkness and whose desire is to bring all people to a world of light, be with us. In our hearts and in our minds, on our lips and in our actions of our hands, when we see the world around us falling apart. Help us to remember that you are in charge of all things and that your hand has brought us safe thus far, and then help us to encourage others and for the facing of the hour of trial. Grant, O God, of mercy and compassion, of strength and of healing, the tender touch of your inward spirit upon those who fear and despair this day. Bless with a vision of joy and peace all those who experience loneliness and struggle. Pour out your energy upon those whose light is fading and shine upon all those who sit in darkness. We also pray, O Lord, for those in authority throughout the nations of the earth. Grant them a vision of your kingdom come to this world and show them how to make it real in their conduct and their governance. Loving God, we lift up before you those whom you've placed in our hearts this day. We bring before you those prayers that have been spoken aloud and those whom we now bring before you from the silence of our hearts. God, we pray for your church and its mission in the world. We ask you to bless all your children and pour your spirit upon us, bringing healing, comfort, and strength wherever it is needed. All this we ask in the name of the one who calls us forward in faith, Jesus Christ, our Lord. even as we pray together the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And let us sing together our prayer response. Entering into that season when we think about how and how much we give to the support, the missions and ministries of this church. We're beginning work on the 2022 budget. You will soon receive a stewardship letter in the mail that will ask you to prayerfully consider what you might pledge to the church in the coming season. And so beginning today and over the next few weeks, we're going to have some different people from the congregation come forward and just talk about why this church is important to them and why they give. And we're going to kick it off this morning with Kay Galloway.
Well, ever since COVID hit, it's been a challenging time in our personal lives and in the life of our church. You see one of the benefits in these lovely screens above us. Through private donations, we spent close to $50,000 to bring this new development into our church. So thank you to the many people who contributed. As Pastor Jim said, it is the time of stewardship, and we will be welcoming different members of our church that speaks about what the church means to them. I would just like to say that I was baptized in the Congregational Church in Topsfield, Massachusetts, which is where my parents were married. I grew up in Boxford, which is just the other side of Haverhill, and First Church Congregational, went to Pilgrim Fellowship. And when I retired from life overseas, I came to this church. I will tell you one amusing anecdote from the time that I was attending the General Protestant Worship Service at Brunsum in the Netherlands. And they rotated who was going to do the organ or the piano for the church service. They had this one nice young lady who was homeschooled. And during the offertory, she had chosen this lovely classical piece of music by Rimsky-Korsakov. Well, a ripple of laughter went across the church congregation that day because she had chosen to play what we know as I'm a Stranger in Paradise. So Pastor Jim had something similar to share with me. But we are going to be looking at what our church means to us. And I just find it very soothing to come here. I especially love the hymns. But as we lead into fiscal year 2022, we have council meetings once a month, and our support team leader is Chet Ballou. Linda Fisher is another team leader. Chris Diamond is another team leader. Marilyn Prell is another team leader. And many of these people will be speaking on a weekly basis. This is going to lead up to the annual general meeting, which happens in January. And as Pastor Jim said, you will be receiving the budget, which looks like this. Hank Reel does a wonderful job preparing it. And you will receive the annual pledge letter, then the envelope, and we encourage you to show courage as you make your decision about your support of our church. So I have a little quote about courage from C.S. Lewis. He said, "Courage is not simply one of the virtues, but the form of every virtue at the breaking point." Another quote that I used with my school children when I was principal of the high school at Naples, Italy, I got tired one day, as did the faculty, of listening to four-letter words, and I said at a pep rally, I said, you know, you don't have to practice those words in front of the faculty and I. I said, I hate to tell you this, but we know all those words. I said, I'm going to teach you 10 little two-letter words. And so the 10 little two-letter words are, if it is to be, it is up to me. And I made all 600 of them recite it. Many years later, after I'm retired and living in Atkinson, New Hampshire, I'm on Facebook, and out of the ether comes, if it is to be, it is up to me. So in terms of continuing the life of this church, I encourage you to remember those 10 little two-letter words, because it is up to each of us to share what we're going to do in supporting this church. In conclusion, from Romans 15, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Again, thank you for your consideration, and I hope you will be generous when the envelope arrives at your home. Thank you.
Thank you, Kay. Our offering is a faith statement by offering a small piece of what God has given to us back to God and God's work here on earth through this church, this community of faith. So I encourage you, as Kay said, to be as generous as you feel called to be so that we can do what the great work that is before us. Our offertory this morning is called Hear Our Prayer.
Pray in faith.
Our second scripture reading this morning comes as we continue through Mark's Gospel from the 13th chapter, verse 1 through 8. As Jesus was leaving the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what massive stones, what magnificent buildings." "Do you see all these great buildings?" replied Jesus. "Not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to be fulfilled?" Jesus said to them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, claiming, 'I am he,' and will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines. These are the beginnings of the birth pains." Thus ends our reading from Scripture this day. May God lend understanding to our hearing of God's word. So way back in 1936, a movie was made of the Broadway play, The Green Pastures. The movie had an all-black cast, and I don't know that you could make that movie today, actually, when I think about it. Rex Ingram starred as DeLord. The Hall Johnson Choir were angels with cardboard wings. Oscar Polk starred as Gabriel, who started the movie by saying, "Gangway for the Lord God Jehovah." The Lord was constantly criticizing the angels, telling them to stop dancing around the moon, and every once in a while he would go down to earth and tell humankind to stop drinking and gambling, and to tell Noah to not forget to label all the animals with a cardboard sign so he won't forget which ones are which. At one point, God gets so mad about all the wickedness on earth that he exclaims, "Even being God ain't no bed of roses." The movie tells the story of how God first sent Moses and the prophets to call the people back to him, and when all else failed, sent his son to share in their suffering. All the angels, though, grow exasperated with the rebellion of humankind, and time again in the play, Gabriel wants to blow his horn, which will bring it all to an end. Gabriel repeatedly implores God, "Now, God, can I blow the trumpet now?" But each time, God holds out in patience. Finally, one of the angels watching the chaos on earth exclaims, "Everything nailed down is coming loose." And yet God still would not give up. Maybe you felt that way at some point in time in your life. Maybe you felt that everything that was nailed down was coming loose. Sometimes there may have been some seismic event that shook your world beyond recognition. The Bible provides us hope for times like that. For the Bible often speaks to people facing cataclysmic events. The history of Israel tells us of times when the chosen people of Israel were slaves in Egypt, conquered by the Assyrians, deported into exile by the Babylonians. The apocalyptic portions of the book of Daniel were written for just such traumatic times. And then in the New Testament, early Christians faced persecutions and torture. Jesus' own crucifixion set the stage for the kind of martyrdom that many of his disciples experienced. The Emperor Nero visited horrific persecutions upon Christians. The words we read today from the 13th chapter of Mark provide hope for people facing those sort of terrible events. It's sometimes called, Mark 13, the little apocalypse. The book of Revelation provides even a further apocalyptic view of hope for people in despair. I was struck by the word earthquake in today's scripture, and so I looked through the Bible to find out how many times earthquakes were mentioned. I found 13 of them. In 1 Kings, Elijah meets God on Mount Horeb. God says to Elijah, go out and stand on the mountain before God. Then God passed by. Then came a wind so strong that it split mountains, broke rock into pieces. And the scripture records, the Lord was not in the wind. And then after the wind came an earthquake. But again, the scripture records that God was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But God was not in the fire. And after the fire was silence. And it was in the silence that Elijah heard the small voice of God. Then we can jump to Isaiah 29, where the scripture says, she will be visited by the God of armies with thunder and earthquake and great noise, with whirlwind and storm, and with the flame of a devouring fire. So pretty uplifting so far. A historical earthquake is mentioned in passing in Amos and in Zechariah. Matthew 27 tells us that an earthquake occurred as Jesus was dying on the cross. And then in 28th chapter of Matthew, behold, there was a great earthquake at the resurrection when the angel of the Lord descended from the sky and came and rolled away the stone. In the 16th chapter of Acts, Paul and Silas are in prison when there was a great earthquake that shook the foundations of the prison, and so that the doors were opened, everyone's bonds were loosened, and they were able to walk free. And then in the book of Revelation, we get five earthquakes, chapter 6, 8, twice, and 11, and then 16. So on some level, biblical writers are kind of fascinated by earthquakes and sometimes refer to them to make a point. An earthquake is a great image for a cataclysmic moment when everything nailed down is coming loose. Because earthquakes threaten our assumptions about the stability of life. We like to think of the earth as rock solid, but sometimes the earth moves. Sometimes when people fear flying on a plane, they resort to the ancient Latin just asking to bring me back to terra firma. We expect the ground to be firm. We want our buildings tied to the bedrock because our foundations need to tie to something that won't move. We are easily lured into the same, thinking the same about our lives. We expect, we crave stability. We expect our lives to be rock solid. But then when something traumatic happens, and even then everything nailed down can be coming loose. The noted theologian Paul Tillich once wrote a sermon entitled The Shaking of the Foundations. His sermon reflected on the devastation of World War II, the Holocaust, the invention of the atomic bomb, and if there was a time when the foundations of the world shook, that was surely it. Tillich makes the point that God had laid the foundations of the earth, but humankind had discovered its undoing. The power of a nuclear weapon is merely releasing the power that was harnessed by God in the beginning. The explosion of the bomb comes from splitting the atom, and in it is incredible power. And Tillich points out that this same power was captured by God, tamed and balanced in creation. Now humankind has the power to undo creation. We have enough nuclear-tipped rockets aimed at one another to destroy the earth many times over, and the question still lingers, what will we do with this terrible ability? Will we destroy the foundations of our own earth? You know, for decades, our national defense strategy depended on what was called mutually assured destruction, with the appropriate acronym MAD. We kept the Russians from firing their nuclear weapons at us by having enough weapons aiming back at them to ensure mutual destruction. And they returned the favor. And as strange a defense as it seems, it sort of worked. Sometimes I think mutually assured destruction is the strategy that some people take into their relationships. People who relate to one another as a private form of nuclear warfare. When disagreements occur, one party or sometimes both have their finger poised over that red button and are fully prepared to destroy one another, to launch mutually assured destruction I've seen it all too often, and I'm sure that you have too. The image of an earthquake portrays our destruction as an act of God. It pictures us as passive recipients of the disaster that hits. But if we're being honest, most of the time, the destruction is of our own making. It was that way for the people of Israel. The major thesis of the prophets of old was that the Hebrew people were turning from God and bringing destruction on themselves. I was recently reading through Amos's book again. The prophet couches the judgment of God with a repeated phrase, "For three transgressions of Moab, yes, for four, I will not turn away its punishment." And then we get to chapter 5, and Amos explains that they have brought the destruction upon themselves through taking bribes, for pushing aside the needy, for trampling on the poor, and then offering an empty worship to try to cover up all their misdeeds. Isaiah wrote in about the same time as Amos, and he witnessed the destruction of the northern kingdom at the hands of the Assyrians, the same thing that would happen to the southern kingdom 100 years later. It was a devastating time, and Isaiah uses earthquake imagery to describe the events. He said, "The foundations of the earth tremble. The earth is utterly broken. The earth is torn apart. The earth is shaken violently. The earth will stagger like a drunken man and sway back and forth like a hammock. Its disobedience will be heavy upon it, and it will fall and not rise again." So, what do you do when everything nailed down is coming loose? And times like these, we need more than just a message of judgment. We also need hope. And that actually is the purpose of all that apocalyptic literature in the Bible, to give hope for people in desperate circumstances. Isaiah says, "To lift up your eyes to the heavens and look on the earth beneath, for the heavens shall vanish away like smoke. The earth shall wax old like a garment. All those who dwell therein shall die in the same way, but my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness shall not be abolished. Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on you." Amos concludes his message of hope when he says, "But let justice roll on like rivers and righteousness like a mighty stream." And he calls on the people to turn away from their mutually assured destruction. He says over and over, "Seek God and you will live." And so we get back to the 13th chapter of Mark. We're speaking of events of the end times, and he warns that there will be wars and rumors of wars and earthquakes and famines and false messiahs and false prophets. In verses 24 and 25, "The sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will be falling from the sky, and the powers that are in the heavens will be shaken." It's Jesus' way of saying, everything nailed down is coming loose. But then he says, "But the end is not yet. The earthquakes of life do not have the last word. That belongs to God. At the last word, the difficulties of this life will be set aside, and God will wrap up human history, right the wrongs, reward the faithful." Jesus ends our little apocalypse in Mark 13 with good news. He says, "Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory, and he will send out his angels and will gather together his chosen ones from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the sky." All these dramatic messages about earthquakes end in hope. Hope is the essential ingredient for seeing us through earth-shaking events. I read a story not long ago about a volunteer tutor who was asked to visit a 9-year-old boy in a large city hospital. She took the boy's name and room number and was told by the boy's teacher that they were studying nouns and adverbs in class. It wasn't until the teacher got to the boy's room that she realized that the boy was a patient in the hospital's burn unit. And no one had prepared her to find a 9-year-old boy so horribly burned and in such great pain, but she couldn't just turn around and leave, and so she gathered her courage and entered the room and said, "Hi, I'm the hospital teacher. Your teacher asked me to help you with nouns and adverbs." And clumsily, she launched into the lesson. The next morning, when she got to the hospital, she was chased down by a nurse. "What did you do to that boy?" The tutor immediately began a tearful apology, and the nurse interrupted her. "No, no, no. You don't understand. We've been really worried about him, but since you were here, he's fighting back. He's responding to his treatment. It's as though he decided to live." She asked the boy, and the boy said that he had given up hope until the tutor came. He said, "I figured they wouldn't send a teacher to work on nouns and adverbs with a kid who's dying, would they?" My friends, when everything that's supposed to be nailed down in your life is coming loose, remember this. God's not through with you yet. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is "Jesus Shall Reign."
Stretch from shore.
Friends, in a moment I will offer a benediction as we prepare to go. We will sing together our benediction response. As we do that, I invite you to turn towards the center and make eye contact with others as we share the blessing of God be with you. And then we will have a short time of fellowship afterwards. I invite you to spin around and say hi to the folks who are online watching on the live stream. And don't forget to go visit Vicki and check out the cards and calendars. And as Adele mentioned, you can see the giving tree. So friends, I invite you to rise as you are able for our benediction. Friend, what endures is not the edifices we build, but the work of God that we accomplish through our ministries in the name of Christ Jesus. So let us go forth from here empowered by the Holy Spirit to be God's instruments of justice rooted in love, to further the work of Jesus and move us closer to God's reign of peace. Amen. So good to be with all of you. Blessings, and go in peace.